Glory and honor to the Lord God Almighty. First of all, I would like to thank God for giving me this privilege, and also I would like to thank the church pastor, Pastor Prabhakar, and Mrs. Marina Christopher, ma'am, for giving me this opportunity to teach the SAP School lesson study for this quarter. I'm so excited to teach these lessons. I'm sorry, last week I was not available to teach because I was engaged with other church. And this quarter, we are going to study making friends for God. And today, we are going to study about winsome witnesses, the power of personal testimony. We're going to study about the second lesson. Before we go further, I hope all of you have your lesson study soft copy with you, hard copy or soft copy with you. If not, please contact me to this number. I'll send you the PDF copy of SAP School lesson study so that you can have access. Thank you. Let's pray before we go further. Our dear loving Heavenly Father, we thank you for your loving kindness. We thank you for Jesus Christ and his great sacrifice on the cross of Calvary. Father, as we gather here through this Zoom, Lord, thank you, Lord, for speaking to us through your children and nourishing all of us from different parts of the world. Thank you, Lord, for using your servants to nurture your church and your believers in this time of crisis. Lord, we pray the Lord to help us to overcome this crisis. Lord, we thank you, Lord, for your loving kindness. Today, especially as we're going to study second lesson of this quarter, Lord, we pray the Lord to be with me. Though I'm weak and feeble, I believe you are my strength. You are my God who gives me strength, who leads me to teach your lesson study to your people. Lord, help me, Lord, to be used by you. Fill me with your Holy Spirit. Lord, I pray the Lord to give me strength. Use me as your instrument. We pray in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Yes, this week we are going to study about winsome witnesses, the power of personal testimony. Let's go further. Yes, this week we are going to study, I think whole week you would have studied this lesson study. Today we are going to discuss on winsome witnesses, the power of personal testimony. What is personal testimony? It is to share what Jesus has done in our lives and how he has transformed us with others. It is to tell others about God's amazing grace and how grateful we are for his salvation. It is to speak of how Jesus loves us and how we love him. So when it comes to personal testimony, it is to share our witness, what Jesus has done in our lives personally. So when we share our life experience, what Jesus has done in our lives, how we have experienced his love in our lives, that is called, when we share that personal experience with others, that is called personal testimony. So it is one thing to share what Jesus has done for someone else. It is quite another to share what he has done for us personally. Isn't it? It is something to say, it is different, entirely different to share about others. God has done some miracle in so-and-so family. But if you are sharing your life experience that Jesus has done in my life, once I was very bad, but now I'm transformed. Once I was very angry, now I became soft. Once I was hopeless, I find hope in Jesus Christ. That is called personal testimony. People may debate our theology, our interpretation of a text, or even scoff at religion in general. But when an individual can say, I once was hopeless, but now I have found hope in Jesus Christ. I was filled with guilt, but now I have a peace in my mind. I was purposeless, but now I have purpose. You see, before I was hopeless, now I found hope in Christ. Before I was purposeless, now I have a purpose for my life, which is called It is our life experience which we personally experience through the love of Jesus Christ. Then when we share this personal experience with others, that is called personal witness, personal testimony. Today we are going to look at the first one, an unlikely witness, the second one, boundless joy, and the third one we are going to look at impossible silence, the fourth one we are going to look at daily conversion, and the fifth one we are going to look at a powerful personal testimony. So today we are going to look at all these five aspects, five topics. The first one, an unlikely witness. Mark chapter 5 verse 20, it reads, "And he departed and began to proclaim in Decapolis all that Jesus had done for him, and all marveled." In Mark chapter 5, we read about a person who was possessed with demons. And when Jesus went to that place, this place called Gadarenes, this is one of the cities of in the area called Decapolis. Decapolis was a group of 10 cities close to the Sea of Galilee. They shared a Greco-Roman culture, not Jewish. That's why we see the people tending pigs, a swine there. So this is not a Jewish colony, but it's a Greco-Roman colony, Greco-Roman cities. Group of 10 cities called Decapolis. So when Jesus entered there, when Jesus arrived to that place, only a violent possessed man welcomed him. Not a big gathering, not a people or officers of those 10 cities. Only a single person, but who was possessed with demons. That person came to Jesus. And when he came, he was asking, he was begging Jesus. He worshiped Jesus, in fact. Let's read Mark chapter 5. Verse 3, we read about this person who had his dwelling among the tombs, and no one could bind him, not even with chains, because he had often been bound with shackles and chains, and the chains had been pulled apart by him, and the shackles broken in pieces. Neither could anyone tame him. We see this person was so violent, no one could tame him, no one could control him. Though they tried to bind him with chains and fetters, he just broke them. It's not because of his strength, but it's the strength of the demons which are living in himself. So that's why this no one could control him. And when he saw Jesus from far, and he cried out, verse 7 it reads, "And he cried out with a loud voice and said, 'What have I to do with you, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? I implore you by God that you do not torment me.'" This person ran from afar and he came to Jesus and he begged Jesus. He begged Jesus, saying, he worshiped Jesus, saying, "Son of the Most High." You see, even as James quotes one in his epistle, even demons worship Jesus. Yes, we believe that. Even demons also believe Jesus. So this person who was possessed with demons, the demons led him to Jesus. It's interesting. When we see that, we think that the demons may not bring the people to Jesus. Yes, that's true. But here in this case, the demons are bringing this person to the feet of Jesus. It's interesting. But it's not for conversion, but for reconciling with God, but to implore Jesus, but to plead Jesus not to harm them. You see, it's very interesting story in the Bible. This person who was possessed with demons, he came to the feet of Jesus. And the demons were pleading, "Jesus, what? The time is still there. Why have you come to destroy us so fast?" Then Jesus said, "Leave that person." Then these demons were pleading Jesus, "Lord Jesus, please do not send us away from this from this area, from this region. We plead you. Then they, the demons, when Jesus asked them, who are you? What is your name? And he answered saying, my name is Legion, for we are many. You see, by this text, and we see in Matthew chapter, Mark chapter 16, we see the demons, when a person is possessed with demons, sometimes it is not one single demon. It may be a group, it may be a group of demons. This person came to Jesus. He was possessed with 2,000 demons. How do we know? In this text itself, we read that, verse 11, now a large herd of swine was feeding there near the mountains. And when Jesus sent those demons, verse 30 reads, there were the, and at once Jesus gave them permission. Then the unclean spirits went out and entered the swine. There were about 2,000, and the herd ran violently down the steep place into the sea and drowned in the sea. We see around 2,000 pigs were there. All those 2,000 pigs were possessed with these 2,000 demons, and they went violently to that sea, and they were all died. And one thing we see here, this person who was so violent, the people were so disturbed by him. Whenever the people goes through that way, he used to just throw the stones and harm them. Sometimes they had to flee without clothes, because this person would abuse them, would always harm them with violent, cruel nature, because the demons were doing all those such kind of evil things through him. And when Jesus healed this person, when Jesus saved this person, the man was restored physically, mentally, emotionally, and spiritually. Now he wanted to stay with Jesus. At the same time, we see the people of the city came to Jesus and they pleaded, Jesus, go away from us. Jesus came to rescue them. Jesus came to give them hope. Jesus came to give them peace of life. But they could not receive Jesus. They said, Jesus, we don't want you. There are many people today. Though they see the miracles of Jesus, though they see the love of Jesus, though they heard about the grace of Jesus, still they say, Jesus, we don't need you. So when this person was healed, instead of rejoicing with that person, those people are saying to Jesus, Jesus, please leave our city. Which means they are earthly minded. They gave priority to the possessions what they have rather than the deliverance of a possessed man. So when Jesus was refused to enter into their cities, and Jesus said, this person who was healed, who was restored, he wants to follow Jesus. He wants to go wherever Jesus wants to go. He wants to be a disciple for Jesus. But Jesus said, I want you to go and tell what I have done unto you. However, Jesus chose him to be the first missionary. His mission was a simple one, to tell others what Jesus had done in his life. So this person who was restored physically, mentally, emotionally, spiritually, once he was a demon possessed, once he was a violent person, once he was a very cruel person, now he was transformed into a good condition. He was transformed as a good person in the society. Now he shares the love of Jesus to the people. Jesus sent him as a missionary. So this person went and witnessed throughout the Decapolis, which means throughout those 10 cities, he witnessed about Jesus, because all those people, they knew about this person when he shared the love of Jesus to them, when he shared how he was restored, how he was healed by the love of Jesus. Then he gave a testimony. He gave his personal testimony to the people. Thanks to his testimony, a great crowd gathered. After a few months later, when Jesus went to that same region once again, we read about it in Mark chapter 8, verses 1 to 10. This person, because of his testimony, there were multitude of people who gathered to listen to Jesus. Isn't it a blessing? See, because of one person witness, the people of 10 cities were transformed. And the second one we are going to study about boundless joy. Mark chapter 16 verse 10, we read about, she went and told those who had been with him as they mourned and wept. Here in Mark chapter 16, we read about the resurrection of Jesus Christ. On the resurrection Sunday, as Mary Magdalene and Susanna, all these, and another Mary, as they went to the tomb of Jesus, they found that Jesus was resurrected. A person who was sitting in white clothes there, that person gave them a witness saying, are you looking for Jesus who was crucified and who was buried here? He is alive. He is resurrected. Then these people, these ladies, they went back. They were silent. They were, because of fear, they could not share. But one woman, her name is Mary Magdalene. We see Mary Magdalene, that when she saw Jesus, that he was resurrected, that day she traded grief for happiness, weeping for joy, despair for hope. When all the disciples were so sad, they were weeping, and she went running to them and she gave them witness saying that Jesus is being resurrected. Jesus is alive. You see, this person who have seen Jesus, the resurrected Jesus, she could not keep silent. She went and witnessed all of them, saying that I have seen Jesus. He is resurrected. He is alive. My dear brothers and sisters, when we experience the same experience as Mary experienced, yes, each one of us have experienced in our lives the kindness of Jesus Christ, the love of Jesus Christ. Just like Mary, we cannot keep silent, but run and share this good news of salvation to the people. Are we doing that? We should also run and share our experience after meeting Jesus, because good news is worth sharing. We always tend to share whatever the WhatsApp messages we get in our smartphones, whatever the offers we may get in the Flipkart or Amazon or any e-commerce websites, we are happy to share whatever the offers they are sharing, whatever the offers they are giving. But I plead you to share more than what you are sharing the worldly things. I plead you to share the love of Jesus, the good news of Jesus, to your friends through your smartphones as well. And we see, however, when she went and shared that Jesus is being resurrected, no one believed. In the same way, when we share the love of Jesus, don't think everybody will accept. There are people who may reject you. There are people who may not believe at first, but please pray for them. Be patient. They will also experience the love of Jesus. Please pray for them. So don't expect everyone to believe all of our words immediately. Eventually, as she shared, they believed when they saw Jesus. The third one, impossible silence. For we cannot but speak the things which we have seen and heard. Acts chapter 4 verse 20. In Acts chapter 4 verse 13 we read, "Now when they saw the boldness of Peter and John and perceived that they were uneducated and untrained men, they marveled and they realized that they had been with Jesus." You see, the transformation of the apostles was so impressive. Even their enemies could see that they had been with Jesus. Because though they were uneducated, though they were untrained, though they were just fishermen, Jesus made them to be the fishers of men. Amen. Because of their being with Jesus, because they were with Jesus, they have been influenced with by the love of Jesus. Now they cannot keep silent. Now they were sharing the love of Jesus. The New Testament church exploded in growth. There were 3,000 baptized on the day of Pentecost. We read about it, Acts chapter 2, verse 41. And thousands more were added to the church a few weeks later, Acts chapter 4, verse 4. Soon the authorities recognized what was happening. These New Testament believers had been with Christ and their lives were changed. They were transformed by His grace and they could not keep silent. Once, yes, by seeing them, the people, even their enemies, could recognize that these people were with Jesus. Because Peter, once a long-mouthed fisherman, was transformed by the grace of God. Now, he was transformed from self-sufficient to Christ-dependent. He was self-sufficient before, but now, after experiencing the love of Jesus, after seeing the resurrection of Jesus Christ, now he became more dependent on Jesus Christ. We see these people, these disciples, Peter, and we read about James and John. James and John, the sons of thunder, who had difficulty controlling their tempers, were transformed by the grace of God. John was transformed from son of thunder to become the apostle of love. And Thomas, we read about Thomas. Thomas was a skeptic before. From skepticism, he was transformed to become a believer. You see, all these disciples were with Jesus for 3.5 years. Still, there was so many things they need to be converted. After they have experienced the resurrection of Jesus Christ, after they experienced on the day of Pentecost, for those 10 days of prayer on the upper room, they have experienced the love of Jesus. They have experienced the grace of God. Their lives were transformed. We know that before James and John were pleading, they asked their mother to ask Jesus to make, when Jesus becomes the king, their expectations were Jesus would become a king, and they want this James and John to sit beside two sides of Jesus Christ, which means they were thinking of possession. They were possession-minded before. Now, when they have experienced the crucifixion of Jesus Christ, when they have seen the crucifixion of Jesus Christ, when they have experienced the resurrection of Jesus Christ, when they have experienced the prayer life of Jesus, and when they were filled with the Holy Spirit, their lives were transformed. Their lives were transformed from self-sufficient to Christ-dependent, from son of thunder to the apostle of love, from skepticism, Thomas became a believer. You see, their lives were being transformed. When we submit our lives to Jesus, just like the apostles, each one of the apostles had different experience. They could share a personal, unique testimony now. Jesus is transforming us too. We should share our personal experience even during hard times. Thank God for this technology. Because of this, the people could share their testimonies throughout the world. Last few weeks ago, we heard about a testimony of sister who was affected with COVID-19 and how she was saved. If I'm not mistaken, her name is Jasmine. I don't know. But the sister, when she shared her testimony, was so thrilled, and we were so strengthened by her testimony that Jesus will not leave us even these times of crisis. And the fourth one, we are going to study about daily conversion. Paul says in Galatians chapter 2 verse 20, I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. Paul, we know about the conversion of Paul. The conversion of Paul is one of the most spectacular ones. Because after the resurrection of Jesus Christ, when the disciples were proclaiming about Jesus Christ, we know that even in Acts chapter 4, we see that the leaders of Jerusalem opposing Peter and James, but they could not keep silence, because we need to respect God rather than the men of this world. We need to listen to God and His Holy Spirit, not to the human beings. So as they were witnessing for God, even Saul, who was a Saul before, even Saul was so jealous about his religion. And he persecuted the Christians. Even he took the letters from the officials of Jerusalem to go and arrest and kill some of the Christians who fled to Damascus. So when he was going on the way to Damascus, we see the encounter of Jesus Christ. When Paul was encountered with the face of Jesus Christ, we call this God's intervention. When he was encountered with the love of Jesus, with the words of Jesus, his life was changed. And it was a one-time change. But in our lives, Paul gives us an example. The life which we live, we need to be converted daily. That's what we call sanctification. Sanctification is the import. Justification is the imputed righteousness of Christ, which is done in one time of our life when we accept Jesus Christ as our personal Savior and when we take baptism. And the sanctification, which is called the imparting righteousness of Jesus Christ, that we need daily in our lives, that imparting righteousness of Jesus Christ, which means we need to grow daily. We need to grow daily in Jesus Christ. And the time is ticking. I can see that pastor is on the screen. So I'm just...
Not regarding time, I'm telling. Just I'm telling. I want to tell that. Okay, justification is a, as you said, one-time process. Means it's a moment. Immediately when we confess, when we repent, immediately God will forgive us and count as righteousness. But yes, again, there is a chance again we may fall. Again we may sin. Again we may fall. Again we may sin. That time also when we repent, God will forgive. So not one time justification. When we repent, when we call upon His name, when we confess our sins, He will forgive us. Justification.
That is called sanctification. That we need our Christian life is not just a straight arrow towards up. Our Christian life is just like ups and downs.
Yes, yes.
Sometimes there are moments we are high in our spiritual life. Sometimes we feel that we are low in our spiritual life. But that's why we need a sanctification, the imparted righteousness of Jesus Christ every day of our lives, because we need His grace in each and every day of our lives. That's why Paul says, I die daily. So when Paul says, I am crucified with Christ, so Paul says that, as pastor, I agree with you. So we need to die every day in our lives. We need to die to our flesh. All of us will be tempted in so many aspects, but we need to live for God. We need to stand for God. That is called, we need to ask Jesus to forgive us in each and every day of our lives, and we need to be renewed daily with His love and kindness. And we see when
one minute, Ramesh, as we take bath daily, as we brush daily. So we need sanctification. It's a lifelong process, daily, through the word of God, through prayer, through submission, through the complete surrender. Daily we need the sanctification process.
Continue. Yes, Pastor. Thank you. So witnessing is not about us, but God. It is to share His forgiveness of sins, His daily blessings, His inexhaustible grace, His everlasting love. We read about these texts in Psalm 103, verse 3, Lamentation chapter 3, verse 23. We see that His grace is, His kindness is everlasting. Daily we experience His kindness. And we see His everlasting love in Jeremiah chapter 31, verse 3. Yes, we see when we experience His grace in daily life of each and every day, in our lives, we need to live for Him. We need to share that same love, same experience with people. And the final one, we're going to study about a powerful personal testimony. Acts chapter 26, verse 28, we read, then Agrippa said to Paul, you almost persuaded me to become a Christian. So when Paul shared his testimony, we see that in front of Agrippa, this Herod Agrippa too was raised in Rome under the protection of Emperor Claudius. He was given the small kingdom of Chalcis and was commanded to supervise the temple of Jerusalem. He showed the people that he followed the Jewish traditions, though he do not believe God, whom Jewish people believe, but he pretends to be a Jewish person. We read about him in Acts chapter 26. When Paul was brought before him, Paul was giving a witness to him. He shared his testimony, how he was converted. Though he knew about this King Agrippa, Herod Agrippa too, we see that this Agrippa was a skeptical person. He was a hard-hearted person. But still, Paul praises him, saying, because of Paul's attitude to look at people as Jesus sees people. We see here, kindness opens hearts. I'm reading from the page 19 in our Sabbath School lesson study. It's third paragraph. Kindness opens hearts where abrasiveness closes them. Paul is incredibly gracious to Agrippa here. He calls him an expert in all customs and questions which have to do with the Jews. Acts chapter 26, verse 3. We see here, Paul, though he knew about King Agrippa, he says that, sir, I know that you are expert in all customs and questions which have to do with Jews. You are expert. And he shares that, his testimony. When he was sharing his personal testimony, we see that while he shared a whole of his testimony, then Festus interrupted his testimony. Then he said, I'm not out of my mind. Paul says, verse 25, Acts chapter 26, verse 25. But he said, I am not mad. Verse 24, we read how Festus said. Now, as he thus made his defense, Festus said with a loud voice, Pawn, you are beside yourself. Much learning is driving you mad. Verse 25. But he said, I am not mad, most noble Festus, but speak the words of truth and reason. And then when he shared again his testimony and when he appealed to King Agrippa, Agrippa says here, we see verse 28. Then Agrippa said to Paul, you almost persuaded me to become a Christian. You see here, we see here, even the skeptical governor was persuaded with the witness of Paul. Paul shared his testimony. You see the personal testimony, how he experienced the love of Jesus in his life. When he shared his testimony, even Agrippa was persuaded to become a Christian. But because of his hard-heartedness, we do not know about his further in his life. Maybe he would have converted 100% to become a believer. But we see here, Paul's personal testimony made an impact on the life of Herod Agrippa too. What God has done in our lives may cause a strong impact in others. We can show them what accepting Jesus and being redeemed is like, and we can lead them to surrender to him. When we share our personal testimony, it pleases the people to follow Jesus Christ.
And also, excuse me.
Yes, Pastor.
And also we can see the power of the testimony of the Samaritan woman.
See, yes, Pastor.
Oh, she's uneducated. She don't know the doctrines, but just the simply words she says. Then the woman left her water, and she says in the book of John 4, chapter 4, 9,
yes,
come see a man who told me everything I ever did. Could this be the Messiah? The whole town, they left the town and made their way to him.
Amen. So
the powerful testimony of Samaritan woman.
Yes,
Pastor. The whole village turned to Jesus.
Amen, amen.
Continue.
Yes, Pastor. The Lord prompted me this morning, even that text into my mind, but I purposely kept thinking that time is short, and also maybe I thought I didn't read a whole book of this. Maybe I thought Pastor Mark Finlay would have mentioned somewhere else. So I thought of using that somewhere else. So thank you, Pastor, for sharing that.
Yes.
And even in my life, I want to share my personal testimony. In my childhood, my church pastor dedicated me to the Lord. Then as days goes by, when I was 16 years old, I thought I need to go for pastoral training. But my parents, they told me, there are many pastors. There are pastors who just came to the ministry just because of belly's sake. We don't want you to be like that. Then I thought for a while and I prayed to the Lord earnestly. And the Lord prompted me. I was thinking of that, I need to go for pastoral training. Then I was praying for that. Then since my parents told me like that, then I thought I should get a job in this world. I need to prove myself that I have a job in this world before coming to the ministry. So then I thought which study can get me a job early. So I heard many people, though they do their degrees because of corruption in our society, in our government, they said, we are not getting jobs. Then I thought for a while, if I do a technical course, I prayed and I inquired with young older people than me. Then they told me, if you do ITI, it gives you a job early. So you immediately will go, you will get a job immediately after you finish your studies. Then I joined for ITI to do electronics in VTDC of SDA. And so I studied my ITI there for 2 years. As I finished my studies in Rajanagaram, VTDC of SDA, I was placed in our school, one of our schools, which is called Asian Aid School for the Blind. I was placed there as a maintenance in charge. As I told you before, my heart's desire was, I want to just do the job for 2-3 years and then I want to quit that job and go for pastoral ministry to get the training and go into the pastoral ministry. As I was working there, we know that Satan has different plans. Satan wants to destroy us when we want to go further for God. But always God is for us. When God is with us, who can stand against us? So when I was working there in Eastern School for the Blind, on September 5th, 2008, I got 11,000 volts of electric shock right there where you are seeing the picture, where I'm standing there near that transformer. If you want to listen to my testimony, please go to my YouTube channel, AW360 Telugu. You can listen to my testimony, a short testimony there, and you can share that link to your friends also. So God, in His mercy, God saved me from 11,000 volts of electric shock. As He promised in Psalm 34, verse 7, the angel of the Lord encampeth round about them that fear Him and delivereth them. The Lord in His mercy sent His angel and He delivered me from the 11,000 volts of electric shock. And as they were carrying me to the hospital, as they were rushing me to the hospital, it was my prayer, Lord Jesus, please save me. I'll serve You as a pastor. Lord Jesus, please save me. I will do Your ministry. Lord Jesus, please save my life. I will serve You in these last days. By His grace, God saved my life and made me as a living witness for Him. May God bless us all of us have different experience in our lives. All of us have personal testimonies to share. So don't hesitate to share your testimony to your friends, though they're of other religions. Just share your testimony, how you are being transformed. Finally, I want to read one quote from Ellen G. White, Counsels on Health, page 32. All who have tasted the good word of God and the powers of the world to come, Hebrews chapter 6, verse 5, have work to do for those in their homes and among their neighbors. The gospel of salvation must be proclaimed to others. Every man who has felt the converting power of God becomes, in a sense, a missionary. There are friends to whom he can speak of the love of God. He can tell in the church what the Lord is to him, even a personal savior. And the testimony given in simplicity may do more good than the most eloquent discourses. May God bless us. Since I have an appointment to preach in Hindi church, I am just request you. I would request Pastor to handle the questions. Thank you, Pastor. It's time for me. Thank you. God be with us.